Orion presents The Boathouse by Stepping Stone Bay by Helen Rolfe, read by Candida Gubbins. Chapter 1. Nina. A gentle mid-September breeze blew Nina's blonde collarbone-length hair as she walked down the track from the main road where she'd parked towards the cabin that had been in the O'Brien family ever since she could remember. She'd taken this walk countless times before, and yet doing it now, after staying away for more than a decade, made her insides churn. Because not only did this track lead to the family cabin, it also led to the boathouse that still stood in the former boatyard in Stepping Stone Bay. And it was the owner of the boathouse who Nina had walked away from all those years ago and not spoken to since. The boathouse came into view, although now that the sun had begun to set, she couldn't see it very clearly. Nina had spent the afternoon with her granddad, Walt, before coming here this evening. She could have waited until the morning, but she knew she wouldn't sleep if she did that. She wanted to get this first visit over with, and then the rest she'd tackle as it came. Walt had given Nina the big torch he kept beneath the sink in case of a power cut, and she was glad she had it now. To stop her from stumbling on any uneven ground, as she turned left past the boathouse to go to the cabin. She could have driven all the way down here and parked right outside, but she hadn't wanted to bump into anyone coming the other way, preferring to discreetly take the short route on foot, at least this first time. For the last 12 years, she had successfully avoided a trip down memory lane by sticking to brief visits on the south coast with her granddad, who lived a couple of miles on from the centre of the seaside town of Salthaven and the bay around the corner. The distance had allowed her to hide out at his bungalow whenever she came to visit and avoid any interaction with the locals in the town or the bay. As Nina's focus changed to the cabin, her pace slowed as memories, a blast of feelings, good and bad, came back to her. She shivered, despite the long cardigan she wore over a summer top she teamed with faded jeans. The cabin, with its warm, honey-brown window frames and small veranda, looked exactly as she remembered. She could recall treading the steps up to the front door time and time again as a toddler, a kid, a teenager, and an adult. And as she reached the steps now, her hand trembled so much, she clutched the front door key tighter to make sure she didn't drop it between the wooden sections and have to get on her hands and knees to retrieve it. She daren't shine her torch beyond the cabin either, because it wasn't the only one down here. There were just two cabins in such close proximity to Stepping Stone Bay, the O'Briens and the one belonging to the McGowans, or in particular, Leo McGowan, the love of Nina's life once upon a time. Leo not only owned the boathouse nowadays, he owned and resided in the second cabin that was separated from the O'Brien families by a mere 13 stepping stones. Up the steps, and the sound of the key going into the lock on the cabin door felt unique, although Nina knew it wasn't. But the significance of her opening this place up after so long wasn't lost on her. After so many years, she wasn't here for a holiday, but to do up the old cabin, bring it into modern times. And once she'd done that, she had been tasked with selling it for her granddad. Something she'd never seen coming. The sale of the cabin would mark the end of an era, and it felt like the final stamp on her leaving Stepping Stone Bay, well and truly behind. Nina stepped into the cabin. The inside smelt exactly the same as it always had. A little bit damp, but not in a bad way. Just in a way that suggested a few windows needed to be opened. Along with that came the salty tang of the sea that had seeped into the walls over time and could never be escaped, given the sandy stretch of beach and the gentle waves were less than a couple of hundred metres away. She shivered, because there was a certain chill that came with an empty place, no matter the warmth of the memories that came with it. There wouldn't be many personal items littered around anymore. Even in the dark, she knew it was in need of some tender, loving care. And more than that, she noted how bereft the inside of the cabin was of chatter, laughter, and togetherness. The sounds and feelings she'd always associated with coming through the front door. She closed the door behind her and reached for the light switch, smiling to herself that she'd remembered where it was. But the bulb must have gone, and so, careful not to bump into anything, she used the torch and made for the table in the corner of the lounge area, straight in front, and hoped the lamp worked. It did, but she'd only just flicked it on when her phone rang and nearly made her jump out of her skin.
William, you scared me.
But she was happy to hear from him, to get the update on his wife and children, their relocation to Geneva a few weeks ago. Hearing her brother William's voice as he chatted excitedly about his new home made Nina think of the children she'd seen on their way to Salthaven. She'd stopped for petrol shortly before she reached the sign to the town, and they'd been there buying sweets and crisps, as well as a huge set of brightly coloured plastic beach accessories, which looked to have everything they needed to build the best sandcastles, from moulds with turrets and rakes for the sand, to little shovels to dig a moat and flags to put on top of the structure once it was finished. Nina and William had once been as carefree as those two children. They'd loved their days spent going from cabin to beach and back again. But they'd grown up and had both left the bay. William for love and his job and his family. Nina for very different reasons.
You're there now?
William asked, after her niece and nephew had both come on the phone to say a hello.
I sure am. I couldn't wait until morning.
She screwed her nose up at the sight of a cobweb in the far corner, illuminated in the lamplight, and turned her back when her eyes fell on the window that looked over to Leo's cabin. The only positive was that there were no lights on at his place. Nobody was home. She wouldn't have to face him yet.
Does it look exactly the same?
William asked.
Pretty much. Smells the same too.
Oh, of wet feet?
She began to laugh.
It never smelt like wet feet. It smells like the sea, but a bit musty.
She knelt on one of the sofas covered in a sheet and opened the small window, staying in her position to inhale the air and listen to the distant sound of waves rolling in. She only opened it a fraction. She'd air the place more once she was here properly.
Are you sleeping there tonight?
No chance, she laughed, looking around her.
The place was bare. No shoes cast aside. No colouring set littering the coffee table. No beach towels draped across the backs of chairs or over a plastic aera. And no smell of dinner cooking or glasses of wine out on the benchtops.
I'll sleep at Grandad's. Just wanted to have a check around and see what I need to bring with me tomorrow to make it semi-habitable. I'll probably stay here on and off while I'm doing it up. Seems the easiest thing. And I can get more done rather than annoy Grandad.
She loved her Grandad to pieces, but she knew both of them would need their breathing space, her particularly when it came to processing emotions of being back in the bay.
I don't think he minds.
Probably not, she admitted.
But she knew she'd be better off if she wasn't hiding away at his the whole time. She had to face her fears. It was high time. And then she had to get on. Get the cabin looking impressive enough to sell for a good price. In the main room where she now stood, she looked over at the small yet perfectly adequate kitchen space with the bench top along one wall that jutted out a bit to separate it from the lounge area. In the dim light, she noted the appliances were all there, but none of the little touches. A mug tree, a utensils pot, maybe a pan stand or a pair of oven gloves waiting to be used. She'd sat at the bench on a high stool as a kid, feet dangling as her gran or granddad made her toast and jam, always cutting it into four triangles, the way she liked it. Nina and William turned to reminiscing, the way only a brother and sister could, with all the joint memories they'd have forever.
Remember baking cookies with Gran? William chuckled. First time, I mean.
How could I forget? She ran a hand along a rather dusty workspace next to the cooktop. She loved making cookies with Gran. It never mattered what sort. In fact, the more variety, the better. And she'd wrap them up into little parcels and leap over the 13 stepping stones to the McGowan cabin and leave a parcel at their door, hoping it would be Leo who found them first. The first time they'd made cookies, Nina had begged to use a recipe for chocolate chip. And once they'd shaped the mixture, Nina had been in charge of watching them in the oven, while her gran hung out the beach towels and swimming costumes. Nina had burnt the lot. She thought she had time to duck out to find Leo and have at least a single game of Conkers with the shiny beauties they'd found that morning, freshly dropped from the big horse chestnut tree near their school. But one game had turned into many, and the next thing she knew, Gran was yelling and flinging open all the windows, smoke billowing out of the oven. Nina ran back inside and, rather than mouth-watering cookies, found black morsels stuck to the baking tray.
Gran said she'd never get the smell out of the oven, said William. She didn't leave you in charge for a while after that, from what I remember.
Too easily distracted, she said.
After a sigh, William admitted,
I thought Grandad might change his mind about selling up. I never expected it to come to this, you there and ready to get to work.
Me neither, but he's set on the idea, so here I am.
Maybe he just wants it to look nicer and have a good clean, and then he'll fall in love with it all over again,
he suggested hopefully. Nice thought, William. In truth, Nina had hoped for the same. She thought her granddad would back out at the last minute and tell her to come for an extended visit with him instead. But he hadn't. And looking around, this place wasn't just wonderful because she had so much nostalgia tied up in it. Its proximity to the bay and the sands made it a winner, and with a bit of work, it could be a luxury escape. Thinking of it that way made her even sadder that it wouldn't be in the O'Brien family for any of them to enjoy at their leisure. And not only that, it made her thoughts flit to the owner of the other cabin, who really had made it his home by the sea and never left. Walt had told them of his decision to sell the cabin over a farewell roast dinner for William and his family as the gravy was poured, the vegetables spooned out of the bowls, and the lunch Nina and William's wife Anna had cooked together was served. When he'd made the announcement, he added a diplomatic, "It's time," when both William and Nina failed to disguise their shock and utter disappointment.
Our family has grown up. It's time for a new family to make their memories at the cabin.
William seemed put out as he tilted his head towards Fliss and Perry, who were 6 and 8, respectively.
Not all of us are grown up. The kids haven't had much time down there at Stepping Stone Bay at all.
It was a desperate plea, even to Nina's ears. Her brother was rarely in this part of the country, and now he was about to move even further away.
It needs a lot of work, Walt went on. It's tired, neglected. And let's face it, you haven't been to stay there in the last 12 months.
William reluctantly agreed.
Work takes up too much time, and we went to France and Italy for our holiday this year. Then we tried to go to the cabin, but the weather was having none of it.
Talk turned to the rain that had hit the last time Fliss and Perry were here at Grandad's, and rather than use their buckets and spades at the beach, or the inflatable ring Fliss had found that looked like a giant donut with sprinkles, they'd played Monopoly and left without seeing even a glimpse of the golden sands.
I suppose it's a lot to do with nostalgia, William confessed as he looked to Nina. We had some good times there, didn't we, sis?
We sure did. But she'd also had some bad times in Stepping Stone Bay, times she wasn't going to bring up here and now. Perhaps selling the cabin would draw a line under all of that at last, because there'd be no reason to return to the bay itself ever again. After she declined the offer of more roast parsnips from Anna, Nina pushed some more.
Why are you really selling up, Grandad? His reason sounded far too simplistic and practical for a man who adored his family and had a lifetime of memories at that cabin as well. He and Grandma Elsie had been the ones to paint the walls. They'd embraced being grandparents by spending every day in summer there with their grandkids. They'd loved the coziness of it come winter, and its proximity to the most beautiful stretch of beach on the south coast, as far as he was concerned.
"I'm getting older by the second," Walt winked at Fliss, who was obsessed by what happened to people as they aged.
That morning, she'd asked why old people's skin looked like the dates she'd had at Christmas. And right before lunch, she wanted to check her great-granddad's mouth to see whether he had any jewellery on his teeth. Turns out she meant gold fillings or crowns.
"I need things doing around this place to make it safer for me," he added, matter-of-factly. "Any changes here would be inexpensive, Grandad," William put in, "and I'm happy to fund them if needed."
"You shouldn't have to." Walt had never wanted handouts. It was next to impossible to give him anything in the way of financial help.
"And I can afford a few minor changes."
He looked at William and then Nina and explained.
"I also want to be prepared. I was able to look after my Elsie in her last days and have her here in our home, the home she adored. And the end was quick for her, but I've seen what can happen when it's not. It's a fact of life, but I would like to live out my days in this house too. And without anyone close by to help, I might need to have someone come in on a daily basis, and that doesn't come cheap. I'd like to be prepared financially. It'll stop me worrying."
Hearing him talk that way, planning for an end, might be part of life, but Nina didn't like talking about it one bit. She would, however, always be on Walt's side and do whatever he needed, whatever made him happy. And that day at their granddad's house might have been for William and his family's farewell, but it also marked the point where it was time for Nina to step up and be the one to take the reins, with her brother so far away. Nina and her brother had talked about it prior to that day already. With William working in Switzerland for at least the next 2 years, Nina was more than ready to take responsibility here, especially after she'd left the bay behind and only graced her grandparents with the odd phone call in a whole year, while William, despite the demands of his job and being married, had come back to see Walt and Elsie every weekend. He'd done jobs around the house. He'd overhauled their veggie patch, fixed up the fence around the back garden, installed a new shed. Nina hadn't helped much at all back then. She'd not even visited for that whole chunk of time, for fear of bumping into anyone she knew and having to answer questions about why she'd left, why she didn't want to come back. Questions she couldn't even answer herself. But slowly, as she got herself together, she braved coming more and more to see her grandparents, and then just Walt, since her grandma Elsie died 18 months ago. Now, at the cabin, Nina finished the call with her brother. "I'd better get on, see what I need to bring back with me tomorrow," she explained, already thinking of checking other light bulbs, the one in the bathroom, those in the two compact bedrooms.
"Make sure there's toilet roll. Nobody likes to be caught out in that situation."
"Thanks for the warning," she laughed. "Give my love to Anna and the kids." She ended the call and was about to carry on walking around to see what else she needed when she heard the sound of whistling coming from outside the cabin. She reached quickly for the lamp and switched it off, crouching down in the corner of the room so she couldn't be seen through the small window above the table with the lamp. She held her breath as the whistling continued, carried inside through the other window, which was open ever so slightly. Her heart raced at a million miles an hour at her first sight, or rather sound, of Leo McGowan. The man who made her heart skip a beat for years until she'd left Stepping Stone Bay behind. He might only have been whistling, but she'd know that sound anywhere. Nina waited where she was, until she couldn't hear anything else apart from the swishing of the sea. She sneezed with all the dust, and she jumped when her fingertips met something that the torch, when she switched it back on, revealed to be an eight-legged creature on its back, legs curled up, a casualty of this old cabin. And when she realised she couldn't stay there huddled in the corner forever, she got up without turning on the lamp again. She closed the window she'd opened, not ready to announce her presence tonight. And if Leo was the only person who lived down here, too much activity would be sure to alert him to the cabin being occupied. And that could wait for another day. Nina did her best to scurry around the cabin and make notes in her phone of everything she needed, unscrewing light bulbs and taking photos of their specifications, looking in cupboards for what might have been left behind. She nipped in to use the toilet. Thankfully, there was enough toilet roll and some soap for her convenience, although she made a note to bring back more supplies tomorrow. It wasn't as if she could call on a friendly neighbour to ask for some, was it? That might be a little cheeky under the circumstances. Before she left, she braved looking through the smaller window on the far wall of the lounge area again. And sure enough, all of the window coverings in the other cabin were down now, a dim light coming from behind. She'd be back tomorrow. And she had no doubt she'd be seeing Leo McGowan again very soon. Chapter 2. Leo. Leo waved the delivery driver off from the parking area at the front of the boathouse and took the last of the boxes inside. As he did so, he regarded the O'Brien cabin. He returned home to his own cabin late last night after going to see his brother Adrian, who had finally settled back in the Stepping Stone Bay area, in a flat not far from here. They'd had a few beers together, and Leo, happy to have his brother back in town, had whistled his way home down the track, past his boathouse and the O'Brien cabin, and across the 13 stepping stones to his own place. But when he'd gone to let himself in through the front door, he'd had the feeling of being watched, and had stopped whistling and turned round, thinking he'd seen something in the corner of his eye. He told himself he must have been mistaken, and with his desperation to use the bathroom, ignored the niggling feeling until he was unable to let it go and fall asleep. He'd taken a torch and gone outside, across the stepping stones, and over to check up on the other cabin. He had a good look around the outside, and nothing seemed untoward, no sign of forced entry. He'd even got a chair from his veranda to enable him to look in through the windows, which had curtains which weren't drawn completely, and it had been enough for him to determine that the cabin was indeed empty, the way it had sadly been for a long time. Not even Walt O'Brien, the cabin's official owner, came down here much anymore, apart from to do the odd once-over of the place. Now, as Leo unpacked the first of the many boxes, he still couldn't shake the feeling that something was different. He just had no idea what.
Jonah, you're back!
The young boy with an accent he'd initially mistaken as American, but was in fact Canadian, had been here twice before. He hadn't bought anything the first time, and on the second occasion, only a keyring with a navy and white sailboat ornament fixed to a silver ring. And on both times, he'd hung around for ages, talking to Leo, asking questions about boats, the sea, anything he could think of. Now, here he was again, still in school uniform, still with the same smile that made it hard to say no.
Do your parents know you're here?
I'm 11,
said Jonah, and then shrugged the way he'd done before, when Leo tried to do the right thing and make sure his family knew where he was. Leo put down the box he'd been about to unpack and went over to the boy who had gone straight to the window at the end to look out over the bay, the sand, and the kayakers beyond.
You ever tried a paddleboard?
Leo asked, when Jonah's attentions moved to a teenager taking one out and wobbling a good amount before he got going. Jonah shook his head, dark hair moving at the same time.
It looks fun, but not as much fun as kayaking.
He put a hand on the boy's shoulder. It's great having you here, and I don't mind at all. You can even help out, like you seem to want to. But I do need to have your parents' permission first. The boy nodded.
I know, he sighed reluctantly. I need to get Mom to come down here.
Or Dad? Leo suggested.
The boy looked away.
My dad isn't around.
Leo didn't want to pry any further.
Tell you what, if you were a customer, you'd be rooting through the racks to find what you wanted. So I don't see there's much difference if you take the contents of that box over there and put them in their rightful places in the shop.
Jonah's smile broke out.
Thank you.
And he charged over to the box, filled with roof rack straps and packets, surf leashes and similar packaging, and a couple of sup leashes. Leo wondered what the boy's story was. What really brought him here to the boathouse? Was it that he didn't have a dad around and wanted male company? Was it a love of the water, perhaps? Or simple loneliness or problems at school? But he wasn't the parent. He couldn't be the one to worry, and his main concern had to be that the boy let his mum know he was coming here, and so he'd remind him again before he left today. When Jonah finished dashing around the boathouse, which was a shop area above the shed that housed watercraft and equipment, to put everything away, he wanted to sweep up.
Seriously?
Leo laughed and gestured to the broom propped up in the corner behind the till.
Go for it, mate.
He got the impression he could have asked Jonah to pick up a piece of litter a customer had dropped, and Jonah would have happily done it.
But your mum really does need to come and see me soon. I mean it. She will, I promise.
He was already sweeping up the area around the counter.
Can I help clean the kayaks next time?
When Leo opened his mouth to reply, he rolled his eyes.
I know, ask my mom.
You guessed it.
Leo was mostly alone in the shop, unless customers came in to hire or he was giving lessons, and he was quite enjoying having his young sidekick. Young boys could be annoying, mess about too much and get rowdy. He should know, he'd been one once. But Jonah had a serious edge and seemed to know how to behave. Whoever his parents were, he'd obviously been brought up right. And he had an enthusiasm too, something not all casual staff had. They were there for the money and nothing else, whereas Jonah seemed to slot in with his willingness to help and sunny smile. Of course, what Leo really wanted was for his brother Adrian to eventually come back into the business, the way they'd always planned it. But Adrian, like so many others, had turned his back on the bay after a summer tragedy, and Leo wasn't sure his dream would ever happen. It certainly hadn't happened with Nina, the girl he'd given his whole heart to and thought she'd done the same. The Stepping Stone Bay Boathouse had retained its name and its position in the bay. Once a far bigger operation for building and fixing boats, it might no longer be used for the same functions, but it had kept plenty of its character, with a long concrete slope leading from the double doors below down to the golden sands and the sea beyond, and the big window at the back of the boathouse, at the far end of what was now a shop, afforded the same spectacular view it always had, no matter the season. Now the boathouse was Leo's business, and a successful one at that. He sold watercraft, kayaks, sups, paddleboards, surfboards and bodyboards, plus all the paraphernalia that went with them. The boathouse also operated as a hire place for the same equipment, and Leo sold buoyancy aids for all ages. They had a range of clothing, wetsuits, fleeces, ocean shoes, and accessories with everything from repair kits and dry bags to waterproof phone cases and insulated water bottles. He ran instruction courses too, popular with tourists who managed to find it. It wasn't that the bay was hidden. Anyone out on the water could see it, the boys marking out the safe and calm waters where lessons took place,
or novices could use the kayaks, sups and everything else in relative safety, but it was more of an effort to find than the biggest beach in Salthaven, which served as the main drag for beach lovers, with its pier, eateries and the cute little cafe, as well as the nearby town to cater for all your needs. Steppingstone Bay was like the calmer younger brother to Salthaven, and it suited Leo down to the ground, always had. It was a place he never wanted to leave, and he couldn't really understand why anyone would. Leo gave Jonah the go-ahead to open up the packets containing new T-shirts, and he began to hang them out for display as Leo saw to his next customers, a couple of newlyweds who had hired a sup each for 2 hours. He knew they were newlyweds because they'd told him how they'd just returned from honeymooning in Spain, where they'd tried stand-up paddleboarding for the first time. Given it wasn't as warm as usual today, they'd both come in wetsuits that reached down to the knees, even though a lot of stand-up paddleboarders didn't bother with the warmth of an additional layer, although some of them regretted it and cut short their 2-hour slot, coming back to the boathouse covered in goose pimples, teeth chattering, and running on about paying for wetsuit hire next time. The couple asked about waterproof covers for their phones, and when Jonah overheard, he ran over with a selection of colours for their perusal, and even explained to them, not that it wasn't obvious, that they could be worn around the neck, so you'd have your device ready for photos. He even added that having the phone in one of those cases, and therefore handy, was a good idea in case of emergencies. It was something Leo usually suggested, especially if individuals came in to hire equipment. He knew from experience, having had to call out the lifeguard more than once when someone hadn't returned at the expected time and the weather had taken a sudden turn. Luckily, nobody had ever come to harm. The majority of them had simply lost track of the time, but having a phone would have cut down on a lot of worry, an extra charge for them. He gave a bit of leeway because it was the polite thing to do if they were in dire straits, and using up valuable resources at the seaside where things could go from fun to disaster in the blink of an eye, something he knew only too well. "So, you've got some experience of stand-up paddleboarding already," Leo confirmed, after he'd perused the couple's booking form. "A good number of hours, lessons, as well as practice when we were in Spain." The man smiled, his tan still lingering, as well as what Leo presumed must be the honeymoon glow that both of them seemed to have. "Wouldn't mind a rundown of the basics, though," he admitted. "We'll do that out by the water once we've selected your boards and your paddles." Maybe their minds had been more on each other than the lessons over there. Understandable, Leo suspected, although he was surprised he could remember, given how long it had been since he'd been all loved up and besotted with someone. He hadn't really felt that way since Nina, if he was totally honest. There'd been flings along the way. He was only human after all. But no woman had ever really captivated him in the way she had. And no woman had ever left him feeling quite so bereft either. His business had become his one true love. The reason he got up in the morning, the reason he could carry on when he was in so much pain. And over time, he'd adjusted. And these days, he sensed it might be easier that way. Leo pushed away the memories and instead ran through the safety information with his customers. "There is a lifeguard here in the bay right up until the evening, and as long as you don't go beyond the buoys, as I already explained, you'll be in sight," he tacked on the end. More experienced paddlers or kayakers often went beyond the markers for the calm bay, but only with prior discussion with Leo when they were hiring his equipment. Leo selected buoyancy vests, returning to the rack for an alternative for the lady, who was more petite than he'd realised and needed a smaller version, so the shoulder straps fitted the vest against her in the correct way. Both of them had come with ocean shoes, something sup users either liked or they didn't. And so once they'd signed the relevant paperwork, Leo motioned to Jonah that he had to go downstairs. Jonah knew the deal. And what Jonah loved
was that Leo let him go and position the wooden sign out front that said, "Back in 5, wait here, or follow the path and find me on the beach," with an arrow pointing in the direction that descended a grassy slope at the side of the boathouse and emerged next to the doors beneath, as well as the concrete ramp leading down to the sand and the sea. He had a different sign if he was running a lesson, and on that one, he could use chalk to let the customers know what time he'd return to the shop. But this sign Jonah was positioning now was enough when he'd be back shortly. Once Jonah had sorted the sign, Leo slid the bolt across the shop door, and using the internal stairs with direct access to the shed below, he led the way. The bottom of the boathouse was a type of shed-cum-garage with lockable doors at one end to keep all the equipment safe. Leo opened up those doors, allowing access to the ramp at the far side, the sandy beach, and the bay beyond. The doors were nice and wide, unchanged from back in the days when much bigger craft had been stored here, and they made it ideal for hauling hire items in and out as needed, before checking them, cleaning them, and seeing to any repairs, so the craft were ready for the next time. On the sand sprinkled concrete beneath his feet, Leo walked to the correct row of equipment and pulled out 2 paddle boards, handing the larger to the man and the second smaller one to the lady, who was a good foot shorter than her husband. He indicated for them to head down onto the sand, while he and Jonah followed with the paddles they'd need, which he'd selected according to size from the next row of equipment along. On the beach, Leo ran through the basics, and once the happy couple had their ankle leashes fixed on, and they were launched into the waters of Stepping Stone Bay, Leo and Jonah returned to the shed, did up the doors, and raced up into the shop area. The customers would return the equipment at the allotted time, and usually Leo would be there to take it. And if not, his customers usually came upstairs to let him know they'd left everything by the doors, so he could bring it in as soon as he could, if he was with someone else. Lucky for him, so far nothing had ever gone missing. He supposed that was the benefit of not being on the main tourist drag. "You're way faster than me, kid." Laughing as he got to the top of the stairs, after Jonah beat him to the back of the shed, Leo put a hand against his chest. But Jonah had already clocked the time and grabbed his backpack from beneath the desk in the corner with the till. "Gotta go. Bye, Leo." "Shoelaces," Leo urged before Jonah unbolted the door. "Not safe to run with those undone, you know that." Reluctantly, Jonah did up both laces that had come undone, the left worse than the right, as Leo unbolted the door. "I'll be back tomorrow," Jonah enthused. "With your mum." "Yes, Leo," he yelled, as backpack wobbling on his back, he took off at a rate of knots towards the track that led to the main road. "Watch out for cars," Leo called after the boy. The Stepping Stone Bay boathouse was accessed from the single lane road, or more like a track given its surface, with little pockets for passing vehicles to pull in along its length, some of which might have trailers with watercraft, given he sold accessories for private equipment, and people came here if they needed to mend their own craft. There was enough parking in front of the boathouse for 4 or 5 cars, including Leo's truck, with its thick tyres that made getting up and down the reasonably steep track easy enough. Leo waited until Jonah was out of sight, and then picked up the sign his little assistant had placed outside for him when they went downstairs. Leo had one more sign, which was a permanent one, and positioned down at the double doors of the shed below, pointing people up here, should they wish to hire watercraft or shop for their sailing needs. Back inside the boathouse, Leo picked up his binoculars that were stationed at the side of the window at the far end. From here, he could watch anyone who had hired equipment from him, and he took a moment to check up on the happy couple he'd just sent out. He smiled. They weren't bad. Their balance was quite good. And he felt as though he was intruding when he saw them share a kiss across paddleboards. Talk about romantic and still in the honeymoon phase. He watched them head towards the boys, careful of the young lad in his own kayak, who was trying to keep up with his dad, who had just reached the boys and was skirting their perimeter now. Satisfied that all was well, and knowing that as well as an on-duty lifeguard, there was a lifeguard station on one side of the bay if anyone ever drifted and looked like they were in trouble, Leo set down the binoculars. At least today's couple were relatively sensible. Only last week, a trio of teenage girls had hired paddleboards and gone beyond the boys without so much as glancing back. Leo had called out to them using his megaphone, and they'd reluctantly come back to where he'd explained they needed to be, given their lack of experience. It wasn't a hard and fast rule, of course, but he was a pretty good judge of whether someone would be able to cope beyond the area he could keep a good eye on. They'd at least stayed closer to the shore after that, not going beyond the boys, but water savvy they were not. Leo had spotted one of them attempting to do a headstand on her board. She'd fallen off quite spectacularly, and he'd seen her mate attempt a cartwheel from one board to the other, a stunt which did not work out. He'd seen the other girl remove her buoyancy vest and put the bright pink item on her board at the end, ready to do who knew what, and he'd been about to call out over the megaphone again, when her own more sensible friend must have told her to put it on. As he'd watched them, every time they went out of sight for longer than they should have done, he had a feeling of dread pool in his stomach. The three of them had come to shore laughing away, but Leo had wasted no time giving them a warning not to repeat that kind of behaviour. He tried to sound serious, but not a total ogre, but it was difficult, and most of his focus had been on avoiding the attention of the girl who kept adjusting her bikini in a way that suggested she was doing it for his benefit every time she moved the material. He hoped they'd got the message about water safety, but he was more than thankful they weren't locals but holidaymakers who would hopefully move on to another beach and someone else's watch next time. Leo ran a one-on-one kayak lesson at 5 o'clock for someone who'd been gifted with a voucher for her birthday and was thankfully water savvy and ready to listen. And just before he closed, he sold keen surfer and local man Steve wax for his board as well as a new wetsuit, so he was ready for his usual surf session in the morning. Leo locked up the downstairs, turned off all the lights there and back in the shop, and after making sure the front door was locked, as well as his truck parked in the parking area, he made his way home from the boathouse to the cabin, that some would assume was a holiday rental given its size, not very big at all, and proximity to the beach. It was one of only two down here, hidden from the main road, secret to anyone else unless they came to his place of business. The cabin was where he now called home, and he loved everything about it, from its proximity to the beach and the water, to the short commute he had, and the fact he could see his home from work and vice versa. The commute still made him smile every so often, and if he went to the pub and overheard people bemoaning their bi-weekly trips into London for their job, or daily drives up the motorway to the office, he'd be reminded of how lucky he was to stroll from A to B the way he was doing now. Leo lived and breathed Stepping Stone Bay just the way he liked it. He couldn't imagine giving all of this up, not for anyone or anything. Even when the weather was wild and the sea air clung to his hair and he took it home with him, he wouldn't have it any other way. Some days, Leo gave very little thought to the other cabin down here. It was just there, separated from his by the stepping stones. But since he'd inspected the place last night, he was thinking about it again, conjuring up old memories, good times. He hated it when that happened. It made it hard for him to move forwards. And after Nina had left, it had taken him a long while to do that. In years gone by, the McGowans and the O'Briens had fully utilised these cabins as their holiday escapes. The kids, Leo and his brother Adrian, Walt's grandchildren, Nina and William, had spent hours and hours down here every summer, and indeed in the off-seasons. But those hazy days of summer hadn't lasted, and neither had Leo's relationship with Nina. One wild and windy evening, everything had changed. A tragedy had left its mark. As he walked past the O'Brien cabin, Leo thought of Walt. He always seemed well, jolly even, and he was usually talkative when they crossed paths, as long as Leo wasn't busy. Walt always wanted to know about the boathouse and how business was going, and his friendship with Leo's granny Camille saw to it that even though Nina had left Leo's life, their families remained entwined. Past the O'Brien cabin, Leo strode easily between stepping stones to reach his own cabin. When he was a kid, he'd bounded from one stepping stone to the next, turning to do it again back the other way, then repeating the game over and over again until he was puffing and out of breath. When they became friends, Nina had joined in, the game keeping them amused for hours. Nowadays, it didn't hold quite the same allure. With the absence of street lamps, an automatic light came on to welcome him up the steps that led to the front door of the cabin, set back on a modest-sized veranda that wrapped partially around the back of his home. The veranda was big enough to invite a few people over for drinks. It was wide enough for the bistro-style table and three chairs, as well as a barbecue. He'd strung festoon lights from the grand tree on a patch of grass beyond to the tip of the roof of the cabin, and he spent many an evening out here listening to the waves crash against the shore, feeling the salty breeze on his face. You'd think he'd have had enough of it in his line of work, but he never did. It was a cozy place in the winter too, constructed to withstand proximity to the beach and the sea and the ups and downs of the weather throughout an average year. Inside, after a long day at work, Leo wasted no time getting in the shower, the steam soon filling the room and taking any stresses away. Over the years, Leo had taken his cabin from a basic beachside residence to a real home, adding in better quality everything. The bathroom had gone from having a questionable floor and useless extractor fan to having a walk-in rainfall shower and a window to properly get the air in and circulating when you left the room. As a kid, he'd had to endure the drippy effort of a showerhead hanging over the bathtub, but not anymore. Now he stood beneath jets of water that had a bit of oomph to wash his day away down the plug hole, the water swirling and gurgling to its finale. With a towel wrapped around his lower half, Leo went into the main bedroom, which was just big enough to fit a double bed, a wardrobe, and two bedside tables comfortably. He pulled out a fresh pair of shorts from the drawers, hidden behind the wardrobe door, and after another once over his body with the towel, pulled them on before heading to the kitchen, where he took out a beer from the pale yellow retro fridge. The original fridge in the cabin had been yellow, and as a little boy, he'd always thought it was like the sunshine, that it had a place in a home by the sea. And so when it went kaput, and he saw a photograph in a magazine of this model in the same colour, he knew he wanted it and that it would fit perfectly. He'd sympathetically remodelled the kitchen, which was more of a kitchenette given its size, and the way it was at the back and to one side of the lounge area, giving it oak wood bench tops atop glossy white cabinetry with a sleek oven and smooth induction cooktop. The lounge area had been repainted a fresh white with the merest hint of blue, and he'd added in comfy dark blue soft furnishings along with a walnut coffee table with a super soft beneath the feet shaggy seafoam aqua rug in front of the log burner he'd installed. These days, the McGowan cabin, or Leo's place, as it was now referred to by the family, was a beachside paradise, no matter the weather. Leo headed outside with his beer. It was a Friday night, and although he was working tomorrow, Friday was Friday, time to kick back. He switched on the festoon lights and happily sank into the comfiest of the three chairs and put his feet up on the bistro table. He wouldn't get away with it anywhere else, but could get away with it when he lived on his own. He wouldn't do it if he had company. But these days, he rarely had anyone here to reprimand him, although he was working on getting Adrian to come down and visit, to sit with him and soak up the joys of the bay he'd once loved. His brother would get there. He had to. The sea and Stepping Stone Bay were in his blood. And deep down, Leo had always known he wouldn't have turned his back on it permanently. Seeing Adrian so lost was difficult, but being back in this part of the country seemed like a significant first step in the right direction. Not that he'd say that to Adrian, at least not yet. His brother tended to deal with things in his own time and in his own way. They both did. The wall on Leo's veranda was low enough that he could see the sea from here. The bit of beach he'd been on with watercraft today. And if he had a set of binoculars, he'd be better able to see the very end of the pier that sat round the other side of the bay and past Salthaven's main beach. He could just about make out the lights from the cafe at the end of the pier now. And as he tipped his head back to get a swig of beer, he wished he'd had the foresight to go there to grab something to bring back here for dinner. He hadn't been for a few weeks, he was always so busy, but they did such good food, with a specials board that changed according to the seasons. It was only after he'd finished his beer that Leo couldn't ignore his growling stomach any longer, and without much more than a tin of beans in the cupboard and not even any bread, armed with a torch, he trekked from his cabin, followed the 13 stepping stones past the O'Brien's cabin, and went on up the track towards the main road and the pizzeria he frequented so often they didn't need to ask his order. Thick crust with onion, three types of cheese, tomato, herbs and anchovies, along with a sprinkling of chilies that left his mouth tingling. As his pizza bubbled in the special oven, he chatted with the owner Nico and his wife, who seemed to have a baby permanently glued to her hip. Before too long, he was setting off back to his cabin. Pillowy doughed pizza encased in its box, and the aroma teasing him as he whistled a random Italian tune he'd heard in the pizzeria. The festoon lights from his own cabin welcomed him back, but as he drew closer to the O'Brien cabin, ready to pass on by, he froze. Last night, he may have doubted his sanity, thought he'd seen something when he hadn't, but tonight there was no mistaking it. The front door was propped open, and inside someone was milling about. And not just anyone. Nina. Chapter 3. Maeve. Outside, beneath the sunshine, Maeve took two glasses of freshly squeezed apple juice over to Molly and Arthur, the original owners of the little cafe at the end of the pier in Salthaven. Now, of course, the cafe was owned and run by Jo, their granddaughter, who was pregnant with twins, and, lucky for Maeve, looking for extra help in the cafe for 12 months minimum. Molly had her eyes closed to feel the warmth of the sun on her skin as she tilted her head back, while Arthur sat next to her, reading the newspaper, with one hand holding the pages, his other hand pushing the stroller with Joe's one-year-old daughter Ava inside, back and forth, keeping the toddler asleep.
"Thank you, dear,"
Arthur spoke softly, closing his newspaper and putting a hand-painted paperweight on top of it, as Maeve set his glass down in front of him and Molly's in front of her.
"She's sound asleep,"
Maeve smiled, braving a peek at Ava, who looked so peaceful it gave Maeve a little pang of nostalgia for the days when Jonah had been like that, all chubby cheeks and innocence. It wouldn't be long before he was taller than her, the rate he was growing.
"We've had a whole 10 minutes so far," Molly put in. "She usually dozes for 45 minutes if we're lucky."
"She's a ball of energy when she's awake," Maeve grinned. Jo's husband, Matt, had brought Ava in yesterday to say hello to her mummy while she was at work, and when it wasn't too busy. But Ava had only lasted a few minutes before Matt took her outside where she could toddle along the pier holding his hand.
"She most certainly is," said Molly. "She keeps as young as great-grandparents."
Maeve suspected it wasn't only Ava's arrival that did that. According to Jo, ever since Molly and Arthur had retired from the cafe full-time, it was as though they'd shed 10 years. They might both have deep silver hair and lines on their faces that showed lives well-lived, but neither of them lacked joie de vivre. In fact, Maeve felt sure they had more energy than she did if they weren't concerned that Ava would soon be awake again. Molly sipped her apple juice and delivered compliments on its freshness to Maeve.
"You seem to be settling back in just fine around here."
"I am, thank you." Because this wasn't a new town for Maeve. It was a long-awaited return to the place she'd once called home.
"Although it's a big change from Toronto, that's for sure."
Maeve set the tray on the edge of the table next to them and tightened up her ponytail, which kept her dark, wavy hair well out of the way of her customers and their food and beverages. It was warm today, although the breeze she felt while standing here on the pier was welcome.
"I'll bet it's beautiful over there," said Arthur. "Although you haven't lost your British accent. Maybe the odd twang here and there," he chuckled.
"I seem to fall in with a lot of expats over there," she smiled. "That helped keep my accent from changing too much. And it's funny how I've only been back in the UK for a month or so, but it feels like I never left in some ways."
And in others, it felt a lifetime ago. Maeve had emigrated with her parents more than 11 years ago. But when Maeve's aunt fell ill, and Maeve's mum had toyed with the idea of moving back to help her, both of Maeve's parents had realised that deep down, they had a real yearning for Salthaven that they didn't seem to be able to move past. It was the right time, and Maeve knew it was time she came back too. She'd left it long enough already.
"The question is, are you here to stay?" Molly continued to probe.
Maeve beamed a smile their way. As difficult as it was in so many ways to be back here, she desperately wanted this move to work out for the best.
"You know, I think I might be. Mum and Dad certainly are. They're even back in their old house."
"Funny how things work out," Arthur mused.
Maeve's parents had sold up before they emigrated to Toronto and had only been thinking of returning for 6 months, when they saw their old house come up for sale.
"It's a sign," Maeve's mum had declared, and that was it.
They started the wheels in motion, and Maeve jumped on board. Maeve plucked her tray from the next table as another couple took the seats, nodded to Molly and Arthur, who knew she had to get back to work, and pulled her notepad from her front apron pocket to take her customers' orders.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.